Thank you. It is so good to have you join with us again at the same time each week, and we do count it our privilege to be able to spend this time with you and be able to come into your homes. We're grateful for those who write us and have written us. We're also thankful for those who have helped support the broadcast, keep it on the air. We appreciate that very much. We never solicited in any way any kind of money or that, but it sure is a big help, because anything that's sent to the broadcast is used exclusively for radio time. So if you enjoy the broadcast, you would like to help find, we would appreciate that very much. But we don't spend the radio time on trying to get money or anything else like that. That has to be the Lord's work through the Holy Spirit. And if he lays it upon your heart, then that's wonderful. If not, then that's good too, you know. But that's between you and the Lord. As we continue now, we're on the subject here again as we continue, and it's quite a lengthy subject. But we want to cover a lot of things on it, because it's one of the most deceitful things that I've ever seen in Christianity. But this is not Christianity. This is a substitute. This is religion, and that is, who can forgive sins? Can the Lutheran preacher, can the Roman Catholic priest, or can Jesus Christ? Both of these men say that they can. The priest and the Lutheran minister and their writings, and following Martin Luther, that they can tell their congregation they can forgive your sins. I find that to be blasphemy, because I find nowhere in the Bible did God ever, ever give a man the right to stand up and to say that I can forgive your sins. Yet they go to a verse found over in John, says, whosoever sins you remit, they shall be remitted. Whosoever sins you retain, they shall be retained. And they apply this to themselves and not to using the Word of God, which is and tells about Jesus Christ as the one who died on the cross, who was buried and rose again. They substitute and put themselves in the position of Jesus Christ. The Bible tells us in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 5, it tells us specifically that there is one God, one mediator between God and man, and that is Christ Jesus. We find out in Timothy, when Paul had written him, the Holy Spirit said, preach the word, not preach yourself that you can forgive sins. Preach the word that Jesus Christ is the one who can forgive sins, you see. Now, as we go on here, we want to, and we've given several verses here in the Bible. The Bible is full of verses that only Christ can provide salvation, because he's the only one that died on the cross and to took our place and pay for our sins. The Bible tells us that God hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And I am found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but the righteousness which is by the faith of Christ. So our salvation, not of good works. We got to realize Romans 3:23, we have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And then in Romans 6:23, for the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Not the preacher getting up there and exalting himself, filled full of pride, and sets up there and struts and says, I will forgive your sins because I am an ordained minister. Who be do? You are appointed by your organization, sir, who has, and you have agreed to teach what they tell you to teach, or you're out of a job. That's what that means, sir. You are appointed. So therefore, it is no great holy thing that you're any closer to God than anybody else, because if you're really saved, sir, you will point people to Jesus Christ. You do not become a child of God because you're ordained, or because you're a preacher, or because you're a priest. This is all projected to mankind to think that these men are some holy men, holier than you or anybody else. They are not. They are a sinner. They put their shoes, their socks, their shirt, and whatever robe they choose to wear on to impress you that they are God's representative, holier than thou, and they will forgive your sins. What a big bunch of malarkey. Let's go to the Bible now. Now, a lot of you are going to get mad, and you're going to rant and rave, oh, he's attacking our church. I'm a little sick and tired of preachers attacking the Bible, you see. So why not give the Bible and show where the preachers are misusing their power, their authority, but they love to have this authority over you. They love for you to address them as Father and so forth. And Christ rebuked that. And let me just say this. I'm just going to say a word about it, because we'll get on it later, some of the other heresies that both of these organizations teach. But right now, forgiving of sins is one of the most important, because if you believe that this preacher has forgiven your sins, and you're trusting that, you're going to spend eternity in the lake of fire. This preacher cannot even forgive his own sins. Now, we find out here as we go on, and we want to do this. The scriptures are full, and they're filled with those who have a sincere desire to know the truth. And there are many, many people that did. The woman at the well did, and she wanted to know the truth. And Paul, in his preaching, going through the book of Acts, and you ought to read that and see and find some place where Paul ever, ever, ever told anybody that he could forgive their sins. And yet he was a religious. Was he ever religious in Judaism, just like people are religious in Lutheranism or in Catholicism? Oh, they're religious, all right. Yes. But Paul preached Jesus because that's who he trusted for his salvation. Now, we come on down here, and we find out that tradition has propagated upon humanity, as we've said, the most dastardly evil ever employed by some of the clergy to convince the unsuspecting that they have power, the power of Jesus Christ, to forgive sins. Now, we're going to take the following scriptures and unmask the veil of error and illuminate the truth of God's Word. So it really depends on this. What do you want? You want it just to be accepted in the community? You want the preacher to feel good about you? You want him to accept you and tell you you're such a nice person and a good person, and you agree with him that he's forgiven your sins? You are lost on your way to hell. If that's what you believe for your salvation, you are lost. This preacher, remember, cannot even forgive his own sins. He is a sinner, whether he wears a robe as a priest, whether he wears a robe of the Lutheran preacher or any other preacher of any denomination or what, that stands up and says, I can forgive your sins. Let's go to the Bible now and begin to see what it says, all right? In Mark chapter 2, verse 10, it says, But that you may know that the Son of Man, that's Christ, hath power on earth to forgive sins. I don't know anything about the Lutheran preacher. All the scriptures are not going to say anything about the Lutheran preacher. Martin Luther wasn't born until 1,500 years later. So 1,500 years, I don't know what we all did without the Lutheran preachers getting up saying, I forgive your sins, when nobody else did. The apostles never done that. And then, if we're going to say, all right, Lutheran preacher or Roman Catholic priest, you've been appointed by your organization too, to stand out there and convince the people and lord the power over them and control them and to call you Father. And I'm going to say this because the things we're giving out are things that really happen in life. They're not just a little cover-up to get along in the community here, and, oh, we don't want to rock the boat, and we're afraid to say anything because you may not be accepted in this little community here, a little town of 599 people or whatever little town you're in or so forth. When I was going to Bible college down in Miami, Florida, I was in a position where I had the opportunity to talk to many, many priests. I found one that was, he was a little bit arrogant. He was 100% truthful, and I'd ask him, because I asked all of these priests, I said, can you give me a verse in the Bible that tells me how I can know I'm going to heaven when I die? And I've said before, out of about 150, I've never found one yet that would show me in the Bible how I could know absolutely for sure I'm going to heaven. It's always been by good works, God will love you, do the best you can, and try to keep the Ten Commandments, which I found many of the priests don't even know. They'll get to 6 or 7 or 8. I found one that got to 9. But anyway, to make a long story short, I asked him, I said, can you show me a verse? Well, he couldn't. I said, do you know you're going to heaven when you die? Well, I'm trying the best I can. And I said, can I ask you a question? I said, why do you want people to call you father for? When you're not my biological father, you're not my spiritual father, why do you want me to address you as father? And you know what the fellow said? And I was absolutely shocked. He said, son, he said, let me tell you something. And he just let it out just exactly like it was. This comes from a priest now. He said, if we can get people to reverence us enough to call us Father, they will do and believe anything we tell them. That's exactly almost the best I can recall word for word. And I said, you're serious, aren't you? He said, I'm absolutely serious. He said, that is how it is. And I thought, man alive, I've never had any priest be that honest before. But he just put it out. He said, if they'll address us as Father. Now, in the Bible, in Matthew chapter 23, in the first 9 verses, you will find that Christ himself said, call no man Father here upon the earth. And I've had him come back and say, well, that's a return to our spiritual Father. That's what Christ is referring to. because the priest didn't even marry, which if you were to be a priest, you had to be married in the Old Testament. Every Old Testament priest had to be married or they couldn't be a priest, you see. So they're doing exactly opposite, and that's why you got so many pedophiles and homos in the priesthood. And you got a flock of them, brother. I'm going to tell you about an incident that one of their own priests that teaches down in Cleveland, I'll relate that to you a little later on in the message. Whether we get into this one or not, I don't know. If we don't, we'll get it in the next one. And because I spent an hour with this guy, I bought his supper out. He teaches the priest, and he's written two books. But we'll get on that a little bit later. But anyway, this priest was honest. He said, if we can get them to call us father, they're addressing us because, first of all, we're not the biological father, we're not their spiritual father, and even when you come to the Lord's Prayer, our Father, which art in heaven. Jesus Christ said, don't you call any man father here upon the earth. He is not your father. He's not your spiritual father. I'm the mediator between God and man, not the priest that they have pushed out to the public and try to get them to control the public by addressing them first of all. And this priest told me, he said, if we can get them to call us father, then they reverence us enough, they will believe anything we tell them. I said, man, I have that. That was a total shock to me. But let's go on down. In Luke chapter 5, verse 20, the Bible says now, and when he, that's Christ, saw their faith, he, Christ, said unto him, man, thy sins are forgiven. And then in Matthew chapter 9, verse 6, but that you may know that the Son of Man, that's Christ, hath power on earth to forgive sins. In Ephesians chapter 4, in verse 32, be ye kind one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. Not the Lutheran preacher, not the Catholic priest. This is Christ, God in human flesh. In Colossians chapter 2, in verse 13, and you, being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven you all trespasses. That's Christ. That's not the Lutheran preacher. That's not the Catholic priest. And I stand amazed. I really do. I remember one service I went into a Lutheran church, and the fella read this from his, it happened to be in the hymnal. I have one of their hymnals, and it was brought to me by a lady that listened to our radio broadcast when we first came to Walnut Grove. And she trusted Jesus Christ as her Savior, and she brought that to me a few months later, and she said, this is what we have been taught. And it was the fact that the, and she showed me in there. And I have it marked and write down exactly what's in their literature here. And that I, as an ordained minister of God, can forgive your sins. And all of you people sit out there and say, amen, you see. And just like a bunch of robots, you got to do what the preacher tells you to do. They love to have this authority over you. They love for you to think they can forgive your sins. He can't even forget. Always remember this. This preacher cannot forgive his own sins. What does he do? Go to another Lutheran preacher? Does the priest go to another priest and have that priest forgive his sins? Give me a break. When it comes to going to heaven and hell, folks, this is not a game down here that religion, who hates Christianity. Christianity always preaches Jesus Christ and him crucified. It never exalts the preacher, let alone for a preacher to get up and say, I can forgive your sins, or you to be brainwashed enough, you're going to a Catholic priest and confess your sins? This guy can't even forgive his own. And you're going there to confess your sins because you want to get along in the community. The priest will think, oh, you're such a nice person. He has complete control over you, sir. And so does the Lutheran preacher when you say, amen, and you agree that as an ordained minister now, a man appointed who has studied Martin Luther, who's been dead for 500 years, and now he's taken upon himself, following Martin Luther now, that he's going to forgive your sins, and you're supposed to respond by agreeing with him. The one service I was in, I would never do this, of course, but I felt like when he said that, when you say, amen, I thought, what would happen? Of course, I would never do it, never think about it, because I was in their service, I would show respect to their service, and I would never do it, and I would do it to him personally, which I have done to several of them. And brother, they don't like it. I want to tell you, the whole mask of this, oh, just so humbleness, comes down in a flash when you don't buy their teaching that they can forgive your sins. But I felt like standing up and saying, hey, tell me, who forgives your sins, Mr. Preacher? Boy, I thought, wouldn't that, boy, I'll tell you, that would have shook the whole place up, wouldn't it, huh? Oh, man, I don't know what would happen, but I would never do that, because even though even though this man has no power to do it, you still, in a public place, always show respect. You never make a spectacle out of yourself to do that. Now, but let's go on. I want to get some more scriptures here. Let's go here in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 in verse 3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scripture. This is the gospel, you see. Now, in 1 Peter, in chapter 3, verse 18, here's what Peter said. I don't know how they can claim to follow Peter when they do exactly opposite of what Peter says. For Christ also hath once suffered for sins, the just for the unjust, that he, Christ, might bring us to God. It's Christ that brings us to God. He's the mediator between God and man, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. And then in John chapter 1 and verse 29, and we're just giving these verses to you to show the Bible is saturated with verses that never tells a Lutheran preacher or a Catholic priest to get up and say, I can forgive your sins. You come to me, and I will forgive your sins. Man alive. The next day John seeth Jesus coming unto him, saith, Behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. I don't see anything in this verse that indicates the priest or the minister is the one that takes away the sin of the world, do you? Or takes away the sin? I don't see a thing. And then in Romans chapter 11, verse 27, For this is my covenant unto them, when I, Christ, shall take away their sin. In Acts chapter 13, verse 38, Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man, that's Christ, is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins. And if I have a problem, of any kind of a problem, if I'm not mistaken, I don't need to go to my preacher unless he's going to point me to the Scriptures. But don't ever take it upon yourself and tell me you can forgive my sins. Don't tell me if I have marital problems, I'm going to a priest that's never been married, and he's going to tell me how to handle my married life. Give me a break. Give me another break. I'd like for you to go in your Bibles to Hebrews chapter 4, and we'll find out here what God says. And he invites us to come to him, not the Lutheran preacher, not the Catholic priest, not any other preacher. But come to him. He says in verse 15 of the fourth chapter of the book of Hebrews, he says, For we have not a high priest which cannot be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, but was in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. Notice what he says. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace and help to help in time of need. What does Christ say? Come to the throne of grace. I don't need a Lutheran preacher. I don't need a Catholic priest. I have Jesus Christ, and if I have a problem, I'm going to them, not some man that puts his shoes and socks on the same way I do, and his shirt and his pants and everything else, and now we have women preachers where nowhere found in the Bible. I'm not going to them. You see, isn't it amazing how many people hate the Bible in organized religion today? Now, as we go on here, I want to read you a couple of things here, if I may do this. And we've given you a few scriptures here, and of the many that are in there. This is why every Lutheran minister and Catholic priest should be preaching, that is, that through Jesus Christ and him alone is the forgiveness of sin. Now, when a man gets up and says he can forgive them, you have a false teacher. And if you believe this man, here's what the penalty of this is. If you believe this man just to be popular and to be approved by this man who has put himself as a preacher and sanctioned by an organization that disagrees with hundreds and thousands of preachers that preach the Bible because of their denomination, because of a man named Martin Luther, born 500 years ago and has since died, never heard of him for 1,500 years, and then your decision on who you believe is going to forgive your sins is determined, you have determined whether you're going to spend eternity in heaven or you're going to spend eternity in the lake of fire, a place called hell. This isn't some little game down here that we're playing, like, I just want to, well, you know, everybody thinks I'm a good person and I went there and he's forgiven my sins and I've been baptized and that. That does not take you to heaven at all. None. It's faith in Jesus Christ. For by grace are we saved through faith. Not of ourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. God said in John chapter 3, in verse 16, He said, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. Now, we come on down, and I'm going to say this personally, that I've asked hundreds of people belonging to these two organizations to question their minister or priest, asking them why they cannot just go directly to Jesus Christ for forgiveness of sins. And to ask their priest, who forgives your sin, sir? And Mr. Lutheran minister, who forgives your sin? And you know what? The most interesting thing that I've found, I've heard people say, oh, I wouldn't dare do something like that. Why? You know why? Because you're scared. And this is exactly what they like to do to you. They do not want you to come and ask these questions. They want you to so reverence them that you'll think that you're really going against God's appointed man if you dare ask him where he got this authority. And if he does go to John chapter 20, then you could tell him this was given to the disciples. And if you have that authority, will you show me where any apostle ever exercised this, or the 70 in Luke? And if you claim to have the power of the apostles, why can't you heal the sick and raise the dead? They could. No wonder Christ said, well, which is easier to do? To say, I can forgive your sins, or heal the sick? Well, it's much easier to say, oh, I can forgive your sins. Why? Because you don't have any proof of it. But the proof is in the pudding, my friend. If you can forgive sins, let's see you heal the sick and raise the dead. And if you can't do that, then you're lying to the people, sir. Because even the apostles who could heal the sick and raise the dead never, never said, I'll forgive your sins. The apostle Paul and his three missionary journeys and all the travels that he had, and he led thousands to Christ. He started churches. Sometimes he was run out of town. They stoned him and left him for dead one time. Oh, this man caused divisions wherever he went because he preached Jesus Christ and him crucified. Sometimes they would leave a city, the Jews would, because he bucked their Judaism or their religion, saying he taught contrary to Moses. And then he prayed for him. He said in the Bible, he said, brother, my heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel. That's what he belonged to, Judaism. My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel, if they might be saved. But I bear them record, they have a zeal of God. Oh, they're excited and this and one thing or another. They have a lot of organizations. They have a lot of things going on, but not according to knowledge. They are ignorant of God's righteousness, and they're going about to establish their own righteousness and have not attained unto the righteousness of God. And then in verse 4 of Romans 10, Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. You couldn't find where Paul ever forgave anybody's sins. And yet we have modern-day preachers standing up and saying, I can forgive your sins. That's blasphemy, folks. Pure blasphemy. Sad to say, the clergy of these organizations have almost promoted themselves to the level of God in the eyes of their people. They will believe Martin Luther over the Bible, because what we've given you is the Bible. So they're going to hate me for quoting the Bible, which contradicts their preachers standing up and their priests that are standing up, and you're going to hate me because you're so entrenched into what you have had pounded in your mind for over 100 years around this area around here. Remember this, what you believe, sir, and who you're trusting to forgive your sins, if it is not Jesus Christ, and it is that Lutheran preacher or that Catholic priest, you are lost on your way to hell, because these men, as we've said before, cannot even forgive their own sins and then stand up and tell you that they're going to forgive yours. If you believe that, you are lost, because they can forgive nobody's sins. As we said, sad to say, the clergy of these organizations have almost promoted themselves to the level of God in the eyes of the people, and they have. A practice so entrenched that it would be a sin to question their authority. We find that the prophet Jeremiah experienced the same problem. So really, nothing has changed in the last 2,500 years, has it? I'd like for you to notice what Jeremiah said. The prophets prophesy falsely, and the priests bear rule by their means. Very simply, what do you mean, bear rule by their means? By their traditions and what they say, and they want to rule over you. They want you to address them as the Holy Father and so forth. Get this now in Jeremiah 5:31, the last part of the verse. And my people love to have it so, what will you do in the end thereof? you will do nothing but hear the devastating words, "Depart from me, you're cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." If you're trusting Jesus Christ and not that preacher and not that priest, but you're trusting Christ because he died for you and loved you and paid for your sins, then you'll hear, "Come inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." I don't know where you stand. These messages are to challenge you to put your trust in Jesus Christ, because it isn't a game down here, folks, or a popularity contest. It'll take you right straight to hell if you're going to listen to the preachers that pervert the Word of God. That's why we give you the verses in the Bible. Do you love the Bible? Or is your church just a social club for you where everybody thinks you're a good person? Well, if you do that, you're going to spend eternity in hell. If you want to trust Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you have eternal life, because he's the only one that can forgive your sins, not any man down here clothing himself to look and represent God, which he does not at all. If he did, he would tell you the verses that we gave you here this morning. Well, as your time's gone, it's been so wonderful to be with you. We thank you for your letters. We thank you for writing. Hope you'll take time to write us. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180. Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray, "Even so come, Lord Jesus."